Well, hey, fellas. Welcome to episode 7 of the channel, Phil/Polly going as the voice. And you can see more Dark Souls. And I know. In the last video, I was going on and on about how I'm thinking of spicing it up and introducing some videos that aren't Dark Souls, because they've all been Dark Souls thus far. And that is the truth. I started one for Shadowrun Returns, which was a cool little $20 Steam pickup. Fantastic, nostalgic Neutron bomb, that game, if you played the SNES or the Genesis versions. But not to digress, more Souls for now. I'm actually working on a new build that correlates to some of the buzz that's been going on in the community about the absence of the toggle escape in Dark Souls 2, and what that might mean for stacking poise, what that means for builds moving forward. I'll get into that, some other stuff. There we go. Okay, so we'll give this a little bit of context first, this being this video, and I'll talk about this build, or at least the thought process behind it that I'm putting together, and then how it relates to bigger issues with the community and Dark Souls 2, etc., all the stuff I said in the intro. A couple episodes back, I was bombing around in Orlando and talking about how much I didn't like tank builds, how the playstyle doesn't really suit my preferences, I didn't really enjoy them. And I thought, that's kind of limiting, that's kind of one-dimensional. I want to be an all-around player, so let me put together a tank build in the way that I envision a tank build, and we'll go out and wreak havoc, or try to wreak havoc. I am calling this build the Lion. It's a Leo Ring build, so nothing clever about that whatsoever. That's pretty on the nose. And that's also why I look like a porcupine rocking all of my thrusting weapons here. I got the Winged Spear in the left and the Lucerne in the right, which I think is a kind of interesting setup. I haven't seen a lot of that, and I'll get into that when I get into gear down the way. But the basic concept is to win hit trades with this build. You don't have a lot of mobility with the medium roll and the heavy armor. You've got the Leo Ring for that massive counter damage. And the idea is to be a tank. I was like, all right, I'm gonna be as solid a tank as I can be. And there were a couple of key concepts that I really wanted to hit. I wanted to make sure that these cylinders were firing with this build. I wanted to dual wield thrusting weapons. I wanted to wear heavy armor, medium roll. I was willing to make that sacrifice. And I wanted to be a Blade of the Darkmoons. So there's a faith component in this build as well. And I'll talk about that, because that covenant has been a bucket of fucking cold water, let me tell you. I am not too crazy about them Blades of the Darkmoons, kids. And you know, none of this stuff is novel. I'm sure this build has been made a million times before by a million other people early in the game's life. It's fairly obvious. It's new to me. Like I said, I'm still decently new to the game and trying out builds. So I found it to be pretty exciting. Here's a look at my stats. 95 soul level, so I still got some points to spend. I will probably just sink those into vitality because, again, it's trading hits and you want to be able to survive when you get hit back. One of the things, though, that I really, really dig about this build is the spear in my offhand. That thing is proving to be so goddamn much fun. Those long-range, fast offhand pokes are stellar for scoring counters with my Leo Ring. And a lot of people don't seem to see it coming. I don't think that's a very common thing to see in the left, because you can't parry and the blocking is pretty crappy with it. But this is not a blocking build and this is not a parrying build, which is why I'm carrying a spear. A lot of times people will see a shield, see a parrying weapon, and they'll have a moment of hesitation about taking a swing at you, especially if you've parried them before. I want people to have absolutely no reservation whatsoever about going nuts, spamming that R1 on this build so I can score those counter hits, those massive damage counter hits. So no shields and no parrying weapons like an S-Stock or a Rapier that also thrust but are parryable. I want people to be completely scot-free to swing away so I can score those counters. Sorry, I grabbed a little sip of beer there. Sorry for the delay. So now would be a logical time to answer the question, why in God's name I am playing as a Darkmoon Blade? I don't even have 30 faith, so I can't even use the buff that is one of the primary reasons people join this covenant. I will. I'm leveling this guy up to about 110 or 114 for reasons that I'll get into in a second. So I will get my 30 faith, but I'm not going to take it past that. So my Darkmoon Blade will never be this wrapper of destruction. But it'll be a little extra something-something on my weapon for taking out bosses or teaching a lesson to people in the field who need a lesson be taught. But I am unimpressed with this covenant thus far. Here's a little montage of me trying to invade. using my trusty blue eye orb. Not so great. And it turns out, well, actually, so I didn't answer the question. Thematically, I think it makes sense with the build. It's called the Lion. The Lion is associated with royalty and justice, and Darkmoon Blades are sort of the justice of Dark Souls, punishing the guilty, yada, yada, yada. So I just thought it made sense. Maybe that's just stupid. Maybe that's just an excuse to fuck around with the Darkmoon Blade Covenant, because I never really have. But the blue eye, oh, hang on a second. Here's a cool little shot I captured. The Lion! Yeah! Rawr! So the blue eye, God, that was so stupid. The blue eye orb apparently has level restrictions on it that are akin to summoning restrictions. You can invade people at your level plus or minus 10%, which is different than the red eye orbs, cracked or whole. So as a 100, level 100 Dark Moon, you can invade people between 90 and 110. As a level 100 using a cracked or whole red eye orb, like as a dark wraith, you can invade people between your current level 100 and the level max, 712 or 714 or whatever it is, depending on your starting class. So that's a pretty big restriction on invading using the blue eye orb, especially considering that's the primary mechanism for getting souvenirs of reprisal, your means of leveling up within the covenant and getting a stronger dark moon blade. I don't know why I just stood there and took that. That was weird. For getting a stronger dark moon blade. Unless you want to go farm harpies in the painted world for hours and hours and hours, which kind of sucks. So based on that restriction, I'm thinking I'm going to take this guy to 110, which will allow me to get people between 100 and 120, or to 114, which will allow me to get people between 103 and 125. Those are kind of the sweet spots that I think the community has established for PvP. And then I'll probably just keep the Ulseal Township open, not go take out Manus or anything, so that I can still get invaded by lower level people. So probably 114, and then just keep the township open so I can get a wide variety of PvP. Regarding playstyle of the build, I'm doing a pretty crappy job of showcasing it, because I'm still going through a period of adjustment. I'm still trying to learn my moveset, so every now and again you'll see some R2 go off that even I'm sitting here looking back on and thinking, what the shit were you doing? Because it's a drastic departure from the way that I normally play. I like to play with a little bit more finesse, so I try to evade a lot and to make precision strikes and all that kind of thing. This is not that kind of build. This is the kind of build that you need to use your poise and use your defense and use your counter capability, your offensive capabilities, to just go in and beat ass. And that is taking some adjustment on my part. So I apologize for the low quality PvP going on in the background. As the clips rattle off, I'll get better and better as I kind of get my feet under me with it. So regarding poise, regarding defense, I've been giving this a lot of thought. Oh, we're here. We're finally here. It took us a long time to get here, but we're finally talking about Dark Souls 2 and community issues, mostly community issues, and all the stuff I mentioned in the head of the episode. There's been a lot of talk in the uploader scene and a lot of subsequent conversation in forums and comment threads and things like that regarding the announced removal of the toggle escape in Dark Souls 2. And what's that going to mean for the community? What's that going to mean for play styles and sloppy gameplay and things like that? And one of the purposes of this build, or one of the primary attributes of this build, is high defense and poise, so that you can tank hits. By design, it's pretty sloppy. And is that a legitimate thing? Regarding the removal of the toggle escape, I don't think I'm the guy to make any kind of educated commentary on that, because I'm terrible at toggle escaping. I ensure that I have at least 21 poise so that I can get hit with a curved sword or a long sword or something like that and not get staggered, because it'll take me two or three hits to realize, oh, I'm staggered. Oh, I've got a toggle escape. Oh, better execute the toggle escape. That's just based on me being a noob, again, playing the noob card. And my development within the game is not good enough to sort of toggle escape on impact. The fact that I can't make any kind of educated commentary on it will not dissuade me from making commentary on it. So here comes some uneducated commentary. This is probably monumentally naive on my part, but I've got a shit ton of faith in From Software. Based on what I've seen in Demon's Souls, based on what I've seen in Dark Souls in the time that I've been playing it. I didn't play any of the Armored Core games, but I think these guys know what they're doing, and I think everything they're putting in the game is deliberate. The mechanics in Demon's Souls, the first time I played it, were so unforgiving and so precise and so deliberate, and that is just a huge chunk of charm with the game. And if these guys are opting to remove a toggle escape, I have complete faith that they're going to replace it with something legit or better. Because the toggle escape is kind of an exploit. I don't think it was intended, but I'm going to absolutely 100% word for word rip off Martyr's Brigade on his channel. He made a point that it was like that it was left in from Demon Souls to Dark Souls. The toggle escape was in Demon Souls, and exactly the same toggle escape works in Dark Souls. And for whatever reason, I was fine at it in Demon Souls and just can't do it that well in Dark Souls, but it plays a little different, whatever. But it was left in. And these guys who are so meticulous about the way that their games play and the difficulty in their games and allowing players and demanding players get better in order to advance in the game, they have something up their sleeve to replace this with. Based on what we know and based on what we don't know, which is probably like a 10-90 split versus no to not know. Again, that's giving them a lot of faith, if not faith, confidence. It's putting a lot of confidence in their ability to sort this out. If they're removing the toggle escape after the second game, going into the third, they're going to implement some other system. There is going to be something other than the opponent's stamina that ensures whether you live or die in a stun lock. You'll be able to do something, or you'll be able to equip something. There's going to be some kind of mechanic that allows you to escape a stun lock. So stacking poise is not going to be the landscape of Dark Souls 2. That is my assertion. That is what I'm assuming. Poise has a place in the game, and you make sacrifices in able to achieve it. You make sacrifices in able to achieve high defense via movement speed or sinking points into endurance long after your soft cap for stamina has been exceeded. There are costs to doing these things, and I think that's what makes them legit. Regarding the build, I think this is a great example of it being utilized well. The build and its stamina and its poise and its defense. This guy came in like a dipshit and was cast Tranquil Walk of Peace and was thinking he was so clever because while I'm slow and moving around, he's just gonna dance in and out with his dark wood grain ring and shred me like cheese with his Murakumo. This build was built to counter that with its Leo ring counter damage. I get it now. With its Leo ring counter damage and slow movement speed to begin with, to where he comes in and tries to hit me and I'm slow and can't dodge, I'm going to let him hit me because I'm going to hit him a lot harder right back. And I think that is a legitimate use of the game and a legitimate use of a logical use of armor. That's what the armor is for. Or at the very least, that makes sense to me. I don't personally know any knights or any samurai or any professional duelists. But if I did, I would ask him, and I'm pretty sure they would say, yeah, of course, armor's for protecting you. And the trade-off is movement speed and probably stamina regeneration, which is in the game, for protection. There are some times when you just want to be wrapped in steel and feel safe, like a blankie. And there are times when you want to be willy-nilly fast and furious with your attacks and move around and dance around, and it all depends on the situation. This build was built for that last situation with the Tranquil Walk of Peace and the guy thinking that, like, ha ha ha, check this out. Sirens in the background, sorry. Okay, so weakness wise here's a gank with some casters, and yeah, that lasted all of about 9 seconds, maybe 12 seconds, but caster's not so great. Tranquil Walk of Peace, wannabe clever guys? I think that is actually the Tranquil Walk of Peace clever guy. It is. Great for that situation, not great for the dual tag team sorcery gank. And actually, here we are again with that same dude. Bowing as if in an honor duel. So this was the guy that pulled the Tranquil Walk of Peace crap, just obliterated me in the dual sorcery gank, and now we're fighting an honor duel. What an odd three-sided coin. Actually, I have no idea what a three-sided coin would look like in reality, like an actual three-dimensional space. How would you do a three-sided coin? Who knows? It's not important. But I'd be really curious to hear what you guys think about the whole poise situation, about the removal of the toggle escape, and what you guys think would be better. you know, what kind of system could From Software implement that would be better? I have confidence in them. I think they're going to come up with something great and clever. And based on the track record of Demon Souls, how that played at the time, Dark Souls, how that played at the time, and granted, a lot of these things are just exploits people have discovered over the years, a lot of these cheap tactics or cheap combinations or things like that, that are potentially not intended in the game at all. I mean, gamers always find a way to do unintended clever stuff, shortcuts, and everybody does that actually. Musicians in their gear, race car drivers in their cars, like you figure out ways to push your equipment in new and creative ways as you get more and more attuned to it. Attuned, see what I did there? And I think that's just a natural part of the game. A lot of these things were not intended by the developers, but the developers had the sense to say, you know what? That's a good thing. We're going to leave it. I don't know. I think that's the case of the toggle escape. I think they got something better. What do you think? Let me know in the comments, social media, whatever. See you next time.